Hi, welcome to Granite State Outdoors. Today, our focus is on ice fishing. Our travels will take us from a couple of freshwater ponds to a frozen tidal river along New Hampshire's coast. With helpful guides, we'll target giant bluegills and coastal rainbow smelt. These stories and more, all up next on GSO.
Hi, I'm Mark Beauchesne with New Hampshire Fishing Game. I'm with Mr. Ice Fishing, Dave Gens. Dave, welcome to New Hampshire.
Thanks, Mark. It's really great to be here. You know, I'm a long way from home, but you know, we're still ice fishing. That's what I like.
Now, you're known for the system.
Well, you know, modern ice fishing. You know, we've kind of taken ice fishing out of the Stone Age into the Space Age. But, you know, instead of sticks and clubs, we're using Gore-Tex and Thinsulites and graphites. And, you know, it makes it a lot more fun, a lot more comfortable.
You're using electronics here, Vexlar, which is something that I like to use. You've used it all the way across from Minnesota to here, and you've been successful with that?
That's correct. You know, it just gives you information. It tells me how deep the water is. It tells me if there's weeds or other cover down there. It shows my jig on there, and it, you know, shows if there's fish there. It actually tells me the mood of the fish and how aggressive they are. And it, you know, and I think probably the most important thing it tells you is that there's fish not there. Away.
Jesus.
When you're choosing an ice rod, that you need to have balance between the rod, the line, and the lure. So you choose your lure, and if it's a small jig like I'm fishing today, you got to make sure that the line you use, that the jig will take the kinks out of the line. So I'm using a light lure, so I have to use 2-pound test line. When I jig it like this, same thing's going on down below that you see up on the top. So if I'm using 2-pound line, I have to have a rod that protects that 2-pound line. So when I set the hook like this and I fight this fish, you know, the rod has got cushion to it. You can catch these nice bluegills on light line.
So talk to me about your tool list when you go out. What are you bringing with you? I see we got this Bearcat here.
Well, obviously I'm getting older and I don't like walking as much as I used to. So some kind of transportation to get your stuff out there. You know, a sled's pull easy. It's the stuff you bring along that's hard to pull. You know, my electronics. I just won't go fishing without my Vexlar. I need that tool. You know, little miniature rod and reels. Again, stick here. You know, they're 6-foot rods built into miniature. You know, good reel on them so you can actually wind the fish up. The good sharp auger, you know, the new Strike Light 4-stroke. I mean, I see you've got one of them.
Absolutely.
And, you know, they're just amazing. I can make hole drilling easy and it's actually fun.
Yeah, it is fun because you end up drilling, you know, what do you think, 30, 40 holes in a trip?
You know, I look at hole drilling like casting. You know, in the summertime you cast to a spot. If you catch a fish there, you cast back. But if you don't catch a fish there, you cast somewhere else. Many ice anglers cast in the same place all day long. I do a lot of trout fishing, and this is the same stuff that I fish with when I'm fishing for trout. You know, my hook might be a little bigger, and I might put on more of them. 4 different colors I have here. But even if you just have white ones, make sure you hook them just on the end, and then there's a clear liquid that comes out of them, and that's a natural fish attractor, is that clear liquid. It's really important that you change the bait. Fish it like it's a minnow. If you catch a fish on a minnow, you don't hesitate. You're in the bucket to put a new minnow on, but when we fish the worm type baits, we tend to reposition them and just put them back down the hole again. Put new live bait on, and during the daytime hours, you'll catch a lot more fish. Got a feeling this one's a bluegill. Oh, it's a dandy bluegill. Look at that one. Oh, there is a nice fish. That's what I came here. I drove all the way from Minnesota to New Hampshire just to catch these nice fish. Nothing interesting about bluegills, when they get bigger, they get a little knob on their forehead right here. We dub them the name no-nosers when they get really big. But look at that, it's a beautiful fish. But we're not keeping fish today anyway, I'm not, so he goes back down the hole.
Dave, we certainly learned an awful lot thanks to you today, and I really appreciate you coming to Hampshire to bluegill fish with us, and I'll see you on the ice.
Hi, I'm Denny Corvo, New England's Wild Chef. Today I'm going to be sharing with you one of my signature dishes, duck and wild cherry marsala. We start out with a boneless duck breast. Is you're going to remove the skin layer from duck. Then what we're going to do is we're going to take our duck breast and we're going to slice it in half. Then what we're going to do is simply pound them out, make them into medallions. What you end up with is a couple of beautiful cutlets. Now with all types of game, what you need to remember is you always, because they're so lean, you want to be able to infuse some type of moisture content. So after we season them up, we're going to add a little bit of olive oil to it. Having said that, I've got one of my blends, a sagebrush blend. It has great herbs in it like sage, thyme, garlic, and a host of other herbs, and it works really well with game, and that's what we're going to season up our duck with. Season it. I'm going to take a little bit more, season the other side, drizzle that olive oil over our duck, and just pat it. And there you go. Looks beautiful. Then what we're going to do is we're going to just simply dredge them in a little bit of all-purpose flour. Just repeat that process with the other cutlets. Shake off the excess, continue to coat them in the flour, and get them ready to saute. Super. So now we have our duck. We're gonna get our pan fired up. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna add a little bit of olive oil to our pan just to coat the pan. And what you wanna do is heat up that oil. Now as an added touch for this recipe, I've got blood orange flavored olive oil. Add just a touch of that. Then what we're going to do is we're going to get our duck going. We're going to simply just add our duck to the pan. So we're going to run it about a medium to medium high fire, just as needed. We're going to let it cook for, you know, approximately 3 minutes per side. Then you're going to remove them from the pan once again. And now we're going to get into the sauce making part of our recipe. Take some of that duck fat that we removed from the duck breast. What I did is I diced it up. And I'm gonna add a little bit of that to the pan. Now what that's gonna do is it's gonna render a little bit of fat content to our recipe, and it's gonna add a little bit more flavor that we're deriving from the duck. Simply just render them out a little bit, just like you would if you were cooking up bacon for a dish where you'd render the fat of the bacon. Then what you're gonna do is you're gonna just remove them after they've rendered a little bit of fat. Now what we're going to do is we're going to add a little bit of shallots to our pan. I'm going to add that to the pan. That'll work really well in consistency with this sauce. So we're going to take the shallots, we're going to just move them around in the pan and let them soften up a little bit. In the middle of this process, what we're going to do is we're also going to take some nice dried cherries. And you can get these at most any store. I've got two varieties of them here. I'm going to add those to the pan as well. As they cook a little bit in this fat, they're gonna soften up even more. Now, a little secret that makes this marsala really unique is that you can take stock, I'm gonna pour that into the pan. The one I'm using today just happens to be a veal and duck stock that I made ahead of time. And that's just gonna be absolutely delicious when it comes together here. Then what we're going to do is turn our fire down. We're going to grab some Marsala wine. So what I recommend is that you get the actual Marsala from the Marsala region. You want to choose the sweet variety. So now that you've turned your fire down, you can add your Marsala wine. And that's approximately about 2 cups of wine. It really varies depending on how much duck you're cooking up. Now you can turn your fire up. What we're going to do is we're going to cook this down a little bit and get this just simmering out so we can bring it all together and it starts to thicken up. And another good thing that you can add to this, just a couple of pats of butter. And I'm talking real butter, not margarine. There's a huge difference. Don't let that scare you. The sauce is really coming together nice. So it's going to cook for probably about a good 4, 5, 6 minutes, and then you'll get it to where you need it to. You never want to cook it so far that it cooks down and you end up with no sauce. You get tons of flavor when it condenses, but you end up with no sauce. So you really want to keep an eye on the density of the sauce. So we're fairly close right now to where we want it. As you can see, you know, we have a good volume. Turn my heat down and I'm going to reincorporate the duck into the sauce. So just add your duck cutlets to the sauce. Yep, we had a little runoff from when they were sitting there. Just add that right into the pan. Turn your heat up a little bit. Move those duck cutlets around a little bit to incorporate all that flavor. And again, it's all about enhancing the flavor, heightening the flavor, and really showcasing the duck. It's not about the sauce, it's about the duck. So we're going to turn our fire right off. We've got our sauce right where we want it. Now I'm going to take it over and plate it for you. Hey folks, we're going to serve up our duck and wild cherry Marsala over a beautiful sweet potato mash. Simply just put your cutlets right over. Oh my God, I'm getting hungry. Drape that sauce right over. Bon appetit and happy hunting.
We hope you're enjoying Granite State Outdoors. If you have comments, please email us at gso@wildlife.nh.gov. In the meantime, check out this next story.
We got fish?
We got fish.
Those seagulls are waiting for the food.
Rip out a bunch of holes and we can put tip-ups in.
Hi, I'm Mark Beauchesne, and we're ice fishing with Laura from the Morning Buzz on the Hampshire's Lake Massabesic.
Oh, I got two for the price of one. I'm nervous.
You gonna go up traction? You're there? Grabs a little bit when you get to the bottom.
Want to come see my hole? But see, any woman could do that. My fingers aren't moving to that. I was probably up on the lake at 4 years old, 5 years old, in the Bob House, and my dad was ice fishing. It's just fun. And such family. Good family fun time.
While that line's giving you a little bit of fits, what I do is just pull it out like this off the drag, and that'll help stretch it out.
Okay.
So lower it down just by pulling it right down.
I thought we were moving.
We're out of here.
You can't confuse me. Whoa. This is a good time to talk about spikes for your boots. If you check out Mark's boots, he has these spikes. They come on and off, they buckle right on. Me, I do not have spikes. And what's happening is, when we don't have a lot of snow, or like a couple weeks ago when we had all that rain, everything froze, and now it's just glare ice. So, spikes, good thing to buy.
Uh-oh.
What? Oh. We don't have time to reel. He went from this hole right on over to this one. It's taken off. I got him. You took out a lot of line, because you're going to remember that's where the bottom is. I don't want to tug it too hard. I don't want to rip it right out of his mouth.
Oh, look at that.
Come on
you're
over.
You're close. You're at leader.
Ooh, ooh, ooh. Let him get some line.
Wow, what do you got there, Laura?
We got a pickerel.
Nice one.
Okay, these ones have really sharp teeth. Do not put your hand in their mouth. Look at that. And it's wrapped right around his mouth. I hate pickerel because of their teeth.
Nicely done.
And you always put the fish back in with his face first. You don't want him to get all crazy by putting his bum in first. There you go. Fish one of the day. This is the day when you get from the sun reflecting off the ice, when you get that sunburn underneath your eyes.
See, we're out here for a tan.
Yeah, that's what
another
it is.
Beach day.
I should go grab my bikini out of the car.
You've got your bikini.
We're fishing, aren't we? I was fishing a bikini. My hands are getting cold. Come on, mush.
We'll do the smart thing if these fish don't start biting. We'll pull up our tent, go get warm, and do it again another day.
Nope, that one's a goner.
Crazy.
So it's a beautiful day, Mark. Why aren't we catching any fish?
Well, yes, it is a beautiful day. But with this wind and bright sun and blue sky, this high pressure has definitely turned the fish off.
I came over to get our trap, so had to break off the ice because things are obviously freezing over. As I start pulling up, I get some light on here. So let's see.
What do you got there?
I don't know what the heck. What am I stuck?
Was there a fish on there?
Is it a tree? There's a fish on there too, but it looks like I'm caught in two lines. Maybe he has that line too?
Oh my god, that's crazy.
Look at this. You see it's the line?
I can't see the line. Yeah, I see the tree.
It's a tree?
Yeah. My god! But wait.
Wait, there's more line.
Wait. Oh, there he is.
Okay.
It's a big, big trapper.
What?
I got him.
On how many lines?
I don't know.
I don't know how we managed to do this.
Wait. The catch of the day.
Look at this tree. I'm thinking.
<20. laughs>
It's still coming. Oh, my goodness.
One of the great attractions about ice fishing is you'll never know what'll happen next.
And here's the catch of the day. They go well together.
Yeah.
I'm Mark Beauchesne, and this is Laura from the Morning Buzz, and we'll see you on the ice.
Hi, I'm Mark Beauchesne with New Hampshire Fishing Game. We're right in the thick of New Hampshire's longest hunting season. Rabbit hunting in New Hampshire is a time-honored activity shared by friends and family. Eric Ricard is one of the fortunate ones that started young.
I got into it when I was probably 10 or 11. My uncle got me into hunting when I was really young. He used to take me out in the woods, and I fell in love with it. He'd show me this and that, and then he bought me a bow and then took me rabbit hunting, and I just grew to love it.
Eric introduced his good friend Adam Dabursky to the thrills of rabbit hunting.
I got started into it with dogs, rabbit hunting with dogs, about 3 years ago. But Eric got me in and brought me out once. You know, I've always been into hunting. That was one thing I hadn't really done a lot of.
It's now part of every hunting season for these two.
Sounds like she's doing good.
She's mouthy, that's why. Like, Rocky backs when he gets sent. She backs in between, too. With rabbit hunting, if you get into a spot and the dogs start open up, you know, it's just young and old, it gets your blood boiling, you know, it's exciting.
Kind of stand around where the dog started the rabbit. Rabbit will generally circle back around to where it started from.
When dogs are running rabbits, they're usually running in thick cover, and you get a real quick shot.
We got it right here. We've got a pot pie recipe that is very good. Three rabbits make a 9-inch pot pie that gets eaten very quickly. A lot of people like it, so that's what we eat. Everything we shoot, we eat.
Beagles are the rabbit hunting dog of choice. The beagle song is well ingrained into rabbit hunting. You could say that this sport is as much audio as it is physical. And that's just part of the rabbit hunting experience in New Hampshire. Rabbit hunting with beagles also connects people. A big part of this traditional pastime is meeting up with friends, both young and old.
A lot more social than I think other types of hunting. While the dogs are working, you'll catch up on, you know, old times. Some of these guys we haven't seen in a month or two, you know, catch up on what happened last month.
And that's what makes it nice, because you can reminisce and talk about old times, and you know, it's just a good all-around good experience. Because obviously the older you get, the less time you spend together. It's just how it goes, and you get to catch up on old times, and it's just good.
I'm Mark Beauchesne, and I'll see you in the woods.
For more information on access to New Hampshire's woods and waters, just log on to the Fish and Game website at wildnh.com.
During the winter months, they come, some every year for the past 15 years or longer. Setting up bob houses, preparing for the tide change, and with it, the smelt run. Welcome to a Great Bay smelt fishing village on the Squamscott River in Exeter, New Hampshire.
My wife thinks I'm crazy to come down here, leave a nice warm house, but I really enjoy it. I'm in business for myself, and it takes a lot of tension and stress off you when you can sit here and think by yourself and fish.
Smelt are anadromous fish, meaning they travel from salt to freshwater to spawn. This sweet-tasting fish plays an important role in the food chain for sea life as well as man. Schools of thousands of smelt begin their migration to spawning grounds before the ice breakup, usually during the tide changes. But just when you think you've got them figured out, Mother Nature throws you a curve.
When you've got to hit the right tide, and they run in schools, mostly all night tides have been the best, you know, the night tides. But the other night, it was light, and the tide going out, we hit them. So you never know. I think it's a lot to do with the moon and the high running water.
They've been catching them all week. Yesterday, a guy got 12. He was getting 100, 80. Yeah. He got 12 yesterday.
No. And that's what I like coming down here, because there's a lot of old timers, and they'll tell you how to fish, and you learn from them. And then hopefully someday I'll be that and passing on the knowledge. It's not like it's, you know, you can go up and down this river. There's some holes better than others. It's a guessing game. And if you just listen to some of the old timers and how they fish, your guess is as good as theirs.
The challenge of knowing when and where to fish. But the fish aren't the only attraction to smelt fishing. There's also the people you meet.
Oh, really? The other crew.
You just chit-chat, you just hang out, you see what other people are doing, what other guys are doing, and you walk around, you talk to them, you get to know people you would never talk to or may never talk to again. But everybody's like super nice and willing to chit-chat, and it's really nice.
Smelt fishing, like all fishing, has the rod, the bait, and the waiting. But when the smelt are running, the similarities stop there.
Fish have been running very good for the most of the season, so it's a lot of fun. It's good action. I was here not too long ago. Sandy and I, we came down on a Friday. We caught 75 on Friday, 100 on Saturday, and then we caught 150 on Sunday.
I have a jug of coffee here.
I have an iced tea, I have a muffin in my bag, and I can't never get a chance to eat it. Because the minute I go to touch it, this is what happens.
How you like that? Nice doubles, huh?
Smelt have many secrets. Their populations fluctuate from year to year, and oftentimes on the same night, the fish will hit on one side of the river and not on the other. One way biologists get a picture of how well smelt are doing is with creel surveys.
About how many do you think?
56.
56, how's that exact count?
See, that's where you waste all your time, huh? How many you got?
About 5 or 6.
Okay, how many fish? 12. And how long you been out tonight?
4:30.
Oh,
is that in Colorado?
Yeah.
For Mark, as well as others, the excitement of smelt fishing is one that's best shared.
I have cousins up from Texas. My cousin Zach this is his third season smelt fishing. He comes back every winter. And then I have the two other cousins. This is their first time that they're here smelt fishing. So it's been pretty fun watching them trying to catch these things, because they're not really hitting too hard tonight. They're just nibbling on it. So it's been pretty fun watching them pull it up.
Maybe 4 or 5.
Whatever it takes, get that fish out of there.
Smelt fishing on Great Bay has a rich and colorful history. Part of that history was going to Junior Sawyers in Newmarket for bait. Junior had been supplying bait and tackle for as long as many smelt anglers can remember.
The ice, you see when you look down in front of you, the ice isn't too good there in the channel.
And Junior sells stuff right at the house, bobbers and lines, sneak lines, and you know, whatever you need over there, Junior has.
His advice and knowledge of smelt and the tides is missed.
That you can keep them and everything. These worms here I've had on hand for 3 days.
He's been around since I was a kid, I think. Well, his father started doing it. Yeah. Junior done it for a long time.
With the enjoyment of smelt fishing also comes dangers.
I fell in about 3 weeks ago, midnight. It scares you. You know, a hut blew off the hole and I didn't realize it, and I was walking right where the hut was, I went down through. But it was almost low tide, so it wasn't bad. It was high tide, if I had my hat still sitting here, I wouldn't have been here.
I have a regular Coast Guard jacket that I wear that's a life preserver. And I also have two broom handles. They're about 6 inches long, and I have a spike in one end of it, and I have an eye on the other, and I carry them over my neck, and they come down on both sides. Basically what that's for, if I ever go in, at least I got something that I can grab quick and stick in the ice, maybe to hold myself until someone can get there.
Falling in the open holes or walking on thin ice aren't the only dangers. Because the tides rise and fall, the ice shifts, causing rifts and cracks. But with all its hazards, once you experience smelt fishing, it's hard to give up.
We actually started downtown next year. We went down there, we were just driving by, and we had our fishing stuff. We said, well, let's try it. We did, and they came in, and it was all we could do to get pull in and out, in and out, in and out. I thought it was the best thing. It was great. And I've been hooked ever since.
Each year, smelt fishing offers adventure with family and friends for a few frozen months. Fortunately, memories last longer than ice.
A bad day of fishing's better than a good day at work. So just come down here, get out, and enjoy it. And if you can teach somebody how to fish, that's what it's all about.
Well, we hope you've enjoyed watching Granite State Outdoors. I'm John Charpentier for New Hampshire Fish and Game. See you next time on GSO.